Mr. Speaker, this public debt management bill, Mr. Speaker, is a creature of the public debt management policy, Mr. Speaker, which was approved by the Cabinet of Ministers of the then Cabinet in October 2020, Mr. Speaker. And the document is intended to develop a public debt management legislative framework to improve the quality of decisions and provide guidelines for the structure of debt issuance and the overall operations of the debt management unit, Mr. Speaker. But Mr. Speaker, whereas the bill was tabled, the policy was tabled in October 2020, and that was at the dictates of the World Bank and the IMF. The government of the day, Mr. Speaker, as usual, did not have the courage to come to this Honorable House to pass the public debt management bill, which will in effect put severe restrictions on borrowing and ensure transparency, Mr. Speaker, and accountability for borrowed funds, Mr. Speaker. So as usual, the bill was, did not come into Parliament, as usual, Mr. Speaker. As usual, left it for me, Mr. Speaker. And it was also a condition precedent for public policy loan, a PBL, which again, Mr. Speaker, it puts restrictions or puts a certain level of accountability for borrowing, Mr. Speaker. So in June 2022, that bill was laid for the first time, for first reading in Parliament, Mr. Speaker, and then give time for us to go through it. But since the legislative year expired, so we have to put it back in the House for first reading on September 12, 2023, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the IMF report of November 2022 says that the public debt management bill would be a positive step, and the publication of a debt management strategy would enhance fiscal transparency, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, and that is the difference, Mr. Speaker, between the government of these two parties. We know that it would require a degree of reporting, Mr. Speaker, and a degree of transparency, Mr. Speaker. But it's a positive development towards increasing transparency and sending a positive signal to the capital market, both domestically and beyond. It will say to the world that this government is accountable, this government is serious, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, so the Public Debt Management Bill, but PDMB, Mr. Speaker, it seeks to have a further look at the current public debt framework, Mr. Speaker. And it provides for the following: the administration of public debt management, a medium-term debt management strategy, a public debt sustainability analysis, government borrowings, guarantees, and on-lending, and to reduce the multiple issuers of debt to ensure sound fiscal policies in relation to managing the public debt, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this legislation aims at consolidating and modernizing the laws relating to the management of public debt in St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there are several pieces of legislation governing public debt management: the Public Finance Management Act, the National Savings and Development Bonds, the Treasury Bills Amendment Act. Mr. Speaker, these legislative these laws, Mr. Speaker, does not specify an explicit debt management objective, which outlines the costs and risk objectives that the government seeks to achieve when it borrows funds, Mr. Speaker. Debt legislation under these various acts does not require a harmonization of debt management operations across agencies. There is no provision, Mr. Speaker, for the establishment of a high-level debt committee that serves as an advisory role and provides oversight to government debt management operations. This piece of legislation, Mr. Speaker, will in effect regularize the above-mentioned shortcomings of the current debt management legislation. And again, Mr. Speaker, it speaks to the courage that I spoke about. One of the key objectives of a debt management unit, Mr. Speaker, that is going to be mandated in this piece of legislation, a debt management unit, Mr. Speaker. The debt management unit is to service debt obligations of the government at the lowest possible cost over the medium to long term, in a manner that is consistent with an acceptable and prudent degree of risk. Mr. Speaker, this bill makes provision for the annual preparation and publication of the medium-term debt management strategy of the government. The development of the strategy document will take careful consideration of the costs and risks embedded in the public debt portfolio, the macroeconomic framework of the country, and the marketing conditions when contracting debt. This is a systematic approach, Mr. Speaker, to decision making that can help strengthen the debt management function, enhance analytical capacity, and help reduce operational risks, even where capacity is constrained, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Public Debt Management Bill provides the authority of the Ministry of Finance to act as the sole borrowing agent for the government, that provides for guarantees and other contingent liabilities and for on-lending to statutory boards, Mr. Speaker. So the Ministry of Finance now is going to be the sole borrowing agency for the government, Mr. Speaker, to put some level, to ensure that there's some level of accountability and there's some level of, there's a nexus of the strategic objectives of the government, Mr. Speaker, as it relates to statutory boards, Mr. Speaker. So the statutory boards will be in line with the government as far as the developmental priorities of the country are concerned, where borrowing is necessary, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, that will enable us to select proper instruments for borrowing, Mr. Speaker. Manage government guarantees, Mr. Speaker, the management of government guarantees. Because what is not widely known, Mr. Speaker, is when a statutory board borrows, the government is contingently liable for this borrowing. So even though the borrowing is not in the name of the government is contingently liable. So it's very important, Mr. Speaker, that the Ministry of Finance is aware of the borrowing done by statutory boards, particularly when they are coming to government for a guarantee, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Public Debt Management Bill, it creates, as I said, a debt and investment unit, Mr. Speaker. It sets out the functions of this unit in the clauses, Mr. Speaker. And if you look at, Mr. Speaker, if you turn to part four, Mr. Speaker, of the government on lending, it speaks to how a statutory board can make an application to the minister for government on lending, Mr. Speaker. It also shows how the application is going to be evaluated. And it also shows that under Section 55, the unit, the debt unit will make a recommendation to the Minister of Finance, Mr. Speaker, as it regards borrowing from a statutory board, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this bill, Mr. Speaker, clearly defines the responsibilities of the main players. Responsibilities of the Minister of Finance, responsibility of the Debt Management Unit, Mr. Speaker, responsibility of statutory boards, Mr. Speaker. What it does is that it ensures that the government's debt management is proper, is defined, and it is transparent, Mr. Speaker. This is basically what this bill does, Mr. Speaker. And it's a requirement for a public policy loan, which the government of St. Lucia will receive from the World Bank, Mr. Speaker, once these conditions precedent are met, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as I said before, this bill is a very serious piece of legislation, Mr. Speaker, in that it makes government lending, government loans accountable to the people of St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. And the Minister of Finance will have to come to Parliament and report on the government's borrowing strategy. So no Minister of Finance will, because his mind told him to do it, to take an airport loan for $175 million, Mr. Speaker, US dollars, without tendering, just because his mind told him to do it, and change the entire plan, just because his mind told him to do it, and awarded to a contractor, just because his mind told him to do it, Mr. Speaker, without tender, $175 million. A Minister of Finance can do, just because his mind told him to do it, and go there and change the entire structure, change the entire situation regarding this airport, and put a country in $175 million of debt, when this same airport could be built, Mr. Speaker, without, and that's very important, Mr. Speaker, because you know, what they tell you is SLASPA is the one taking the loan, not the government. That's the excuse. Excuse that's conveniently used many times by people that I don't want to mention. SLASPA is the one taking the loan, Mr. Speaker. But if you look at that bill, it will tell you that even though SLASPA takes the loan, the government is contingently liable for that loan, Mr. Speaker. So there's nothing like SLASPA took the loan. The government of St. Lucia took the loan through SLASPA, or SLASPA took the loan because of the government of St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, in the administration of the bill, the Minister of Finance can delegate powers. And it also speaks, Mr. Speaker, in Section 8, the responsibilities of the Minister of Finance. In Section 8, Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Finance, how he has to report. And that's what he has to do, Mr. Speaker. 8.1. The Minister shall furnish Parliament with an annual report on debt management activities, including borrowings, loan guarantees, and on lending. That's what the Minister of Finance, whoever he or she may be, will have to do, Mr. Speaker. Exactly. The Minister of Finance requirement for him is he has to lay strategy and borrowing plan. The Minister shall lay before Parliament no later than the commencement of the financial year the strategy and borrowing plan for approval by the Parliament, Mr. Speaker. Where every member will be able to express himself, Mr. Speaker. Within 3 months after the end of the financial year, the update of the borrowing plan, Mr. Speaker. So he needs to come and say to Parliament how he has changed that plan, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, you know, so never again will a Minister of Finance be able to do what this Minister of Finance did as far as the airport is concerned. Never again, Mr. Speaker. That is protection for the people of St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. Because you can get, not this Minister of Finance, but you can get Minister of Finance who can do exactly what Minister of Finance did. Change a $175 million loan when all was in place for private public partnership agreement for construction of this airport, Mr. Speaker. All was in place, Mr. Speaker. To change from a loan of 2% at that time for the construction of the Grozile Highway to unilaterally change your mind and give direct awards for less than a mile of road for $15 million and ongoing. That will not happen. That will not be able to happen again, Mr. Speaker, because the Minister of Finance will have to come to account to the Parliament of St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, the people of St. Lucia will not be suffering now as they're suffering on the Castries Grozile Highway because of a unilateral decision by a minister and a prime minister to unilaterally, without the consent of the then Minister of Infrastructure, and if I'm not speaking the truth, I want to stand up and say that's not true. Without the consent of the then Minister of Infrastructure, just to cancel a loan, cancel an agreement for an airport, put the country in a situation where and Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Infrastructure, I'm talking about loans here, Mr. Speaker, spoke about the shock bridge. Mr. Speaker, are you aware that the shock bridge, the World Bank had already approved a loan for the construction of the shock bridge that was designed by the Army Corps of Engineers? Huh? Thank you. Mr. Speaker, that's what this government found. When you hear these guys speak, Mr. Speaker, and I cannot help but telling the public of St. Lucia what these guys did to this country. But you know why, Mr. Speaker? The bridge had to be tendered. It had to go to public tender. So they canceled it. A bridge that was designed by the Army Corps of Engineers, just like the Border Wash Bridge. Remember the accusations, Mr. Speaker, and the lies and the misinformation they had on the Border Wash Bridge, Mr. Speaker. I said to them, audit it. They audited it. They got some of their surrogates to look into all kind of investigations in the Border Wash Bridge. I challenged them, Mr. Speaker. You know what happened? There were cost savings on the Border Wash Bridge. They were actually cost savings. We saved them, Mr. Speaker. But no one is speaking about the bypass road that was built for $3 million on direct award, if no tender. That's what you have to talk about, to speak about, Mr. Speaker. But Mr. Speaker, loan from the curators was for the Grozile Highway. But the Balonge Bridge was a World Bank finance project that went to international tender. International tender, Mr. Speaker. Supervised, the design was supervised by the Army Corps of Engineers. And the Bois d'Orange Bridge was built to withstand a 1-in-1,000-year event, Mr. Speaker. And let's knock wood, the Bois d'Orange Bridge has stood up, Mr. Speaker. It has stood up, Mr. Speaker. It's a specially designed bridge because we had the foresight. The government at the time had the foresight to know that you could not build a bridge if it was not environmentally suitable and did not take the effect of climate change, Mr. Speaker. That's why we built it, Mr. Speaker. There were all sorts of misinformation as usual. And up to today, the bridge is still standing. Just as the member of Castries Central says about the Grozile Castries Highway and the loan from the curators. But because of the fact that they had to be tendering, for the Grozile Highway. So unilaterally, a man took a decision to cancel it. So, Mr. Speaker, I really want members to support this piece of legislation, Mr. Speaker. It's a serious piece of legislation. It's legislation that will impact on the way government finances are borrowed and will put serious restrictions on the Minister of Finance, but restrictions that will benefit the people of St. Lucia and will improve St. Lucia's reputation in the international world. the country's reputation, Mr. Speaker. Because, Mr. Speaker, a member stood in this Honorable House and he attacked the curated government. I don't know if you recall that. Mr. Speaker, I have a good sense of history, Mr. Speaker. The curated government was attacked in this Honorable House. The IFC, an arm of the World Bank, was attacked in this Honorable House. The IFC was attacked, Mr. Speaker, by a member of this Parliament, not a member right now in this Honorable House. And praise God, the people ensured that this member did not return here. And the people will ensure that he never returns. Attack the IFC, Mr. Speaker. Attack the World Bank. But right now, Mr. Speaker, the relationship between this government and the IFC has improved. The relationship between this government and the curated government has improved. And very soon, Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Infrastructure will have some very, very good news for you on the Groziller-Cassis Highway. I thank you, Mr. Speaker.